After the loving of the 70s, the 80s brought to tennis an air of practicality. Looking out a dirty old window, down below the cars in the city go rushing by. The decade welcomed in a postmodern, post-feminist era where no-nonsense Navratilova ruled the courts. With Martina around, everything else was a sideshow. Tracy Austin, Andrea Jaeger, and Carlene Bassett all tried to bring some stateside sex appeal to Wimbledon. Meanwhile, Anne White took the all-white clothing rule a little too literally.
I was actually standing on the balcony when Anne White walked out onto court two in her catsuit. And the whole place just drew breath. We'd never seen anything like it in our lives. And I think there were a couple of sort of All England Club members and officials standing on the balcony as well. And I mean, it's, their faces were a picture. It was amazing. And only Anne White could have pulled it off because she had the most amazing physique with these long legs and long arms and kind of a neat bottom. And, you know, there weren't too many people that could have fitted into that and felt quite comfortable.
The insatiable tabloids then turned to Annabel Croft. Unfortunately, the home county's girl's talents never made it past her appeal. She failed to ever make it past the third round.
My experiences at Wimbledon were fairly horrific, actually, if I'm honest. I always found the whole thing quite an ordeal and quite terrifying. Always suffered dreadfully from nerves, felt really sick before I went on court, and actually could quite happily have sort of bypassed the whole experience.
Beautiful girl, lovely girl. I mean, if you're thinking of sex, big S, she probably was the most attractive of them all.
They said she had two fans, her mother and the whole of Royal Navy Portsmouth.
Annabel, I remember from my junior days as this ridiculously attractive woman, girl at that stage, who spoke with a plum in her mouth, which I found fantastically attractive at the time as a young man, wearing these, almost like these toweling headbands with this long brown mane of hair sort of tied in a plaited at the back or tied in a ponytail. And you actually just used to go and just sit at the back of the court and just watch her because she just grabbed you, just the way she looked and also the way she played.
Would I have flaunted it more? I think back then, I don't know. I mean, probably not. It probably wasn't in my personality back then. Now, at my age, maybe.
Come the 90s, we wanted it all, and we wouldn't settle for anything less. Good-looking girls who would invariably lose in straight sets had been replaced by good-looking girls who could play. The dominatrix was here, and so was the power game. The 1991 women's final was a photographer's dream. Graf versus Sabatini. Blonde versus brunette. Striking versus sultry. And a great game to match.
I was actually there watching it, and oh God, it was an absolute epic as far as the tennis was concerned. And you know, on top of that, you just had these supreme athletes who just so statuesque and so fluid as movers around a court, and so different in style as well. You had this sort of whopping great forehand and that beautiful sliced backhand, and you know, her footwork and her movement around the court was like a panther really. And then you've got this, you know, amazing topspin, very sort of fluid, silky motion of Sabatini on a court. And, you know, she was a much bigger, stronger physique than Graf in many ways. But just so silky smooth is how I would describe her.
Steffi Graf was a real childhood heroine of mine, actually. You know, she was great, athletic, friendly, nice. You wanted her to be your kind of big sister.
It was the German thing as well, it was this German thing. Yeah. There was something about her, she could probably give you a bit of a hard time, you know, and it wouldn't be so bad, you know, it'd be all right, you might quite like it.
She had the best legs in the business, in any sport. I mean, my husband absolutely drools over Steffi Graf's legs, but I do too.
She had these wonderful blue eyes that were almost hypnotic, and you almost just sort of just fell into them. And there was always, for me, something very attractive about Steffi Graf.
Just a beautiful athlete, in every sense of the word.
I wouldn't cross her, actually. I wouldn't cross her, and I wouldn't want to wrestle her, not in a serious way.
Sabatini, a great player, a big sort of flowing mane, if you like, that was all tussled during matches, and it was just, great to sit down and watch, and the competitiveness of what she brought to the game as well.
Oh, she conjures up so many images, doesn't she? This sort of raven-haired, exotic South American beauty with this sort of very deep, husky voice, these very masculine kind of shoulders, but amazing, statuesque physique. A real softness about it. You could see her as a film star in a Spanish-speaking film or something.
It was that exotic look, wasn't it? It was that look that made you just think, oh, she looks like she's just stepped off this beautiful island from somewhere, and it's very, very natural and very flowing, quite masculine. But because of that, I think very attractive as well. She was the first of those sorts of players who looked quite manly, but also very, very attractive as well.
Coming up, we look at the girl who changed the face of women's tennis forever. In the mid-90s, everything would change. Though Graf, Sabatini, Hingis, Capriati and Pierce had their charms, they would soon be overshadowed. There was a new kid on the block, and she wasn't one to share the spotlight with anyone. Her name was Anna Kournikova. Once on the scene, it was a whole new ball game. No one could keep their eyes off her. She knew it, and she loved it. She had everything, except for the tiny little detail of ever winning a singles title. Young, sweet, and supposedly innocent, Anna was just 16 when she first played at Wimbledon. A babe in more ways than one. The tabloids couldn't care less. Anna mania had arrived.
Anna Kournikova, I mean, she is every man's wet dream. She was sort of the first of that wave of Russian beauties, that sort of classic high cheekbone. Russian women tend to have quite round faces, and there's something men have sort of historically have found that quite appealing. There's this idea that there's something quite childlike about them, quite innocent. I mean, she's obviously not very innocent, she knows exactly what she's doing, but men are drawn to that kind of protect me, nurture me sort of thing.
She had this long blonde hair, very long blonde hair, and a very sort of pouty look about her that was very attractive. At the time, of course, she was only 16, 17, so let's say she's too attractive, but nonetheless, you could see what was coming next. And she did, she blossomed into that, you know, 2-3 years later. She suddenly was, you know, this was it. Kournikova's in town.
You had this rather beautiful, elegant, long blonde hair mermaid of a girl. But she was such a contradiction to what we'd seen before. She's the only one who knows how far she could have gone. If she perhaps thought there was a limit to what she could achieve, then she milked it for all it was worth in the tabloid press. And I think fair game to her, because she knew what it was about and she played up to it.